Hello, everyone. Welcome to Common Ground Discourse. This is episode 7. I'm your co-host. My name is Shane Swor.
Godspeed, and I'm Brother Kenneth.
So today, we are going to be reviewing Sam Harris's book, The Moral Landscape. And due to the complex nature of the book and the contents inside of it, we've decided to break this up into a series of episodes covering what we thought were the major topics, which just so happened to be the chapters in his book. For this episode, episode 7, we're going to be doing moral truth. In the next episode, we'll be covering good and evil. And in the third one of the series, we'll be covering belief. So 7, 8, 9 on the episodes there. So to kick this off, let's give a little bit of a background on who Sam Harris is. We've talked about him before in previous episodes. But so you understand who the author is, he's got a degree in philosophy. He's also got a PhD in neuroscience, and he's the co-founder and chairman for Project Reason. And this book is, I think, I might say this too soon, but it might be his magnum opus to his entry into philosophy and neuroscience and marrying those two efforts in education that he's pursued. So that is essentially who Sam Harris is. And the reason why we chose to tackle this book, at least on my end, is because I do think that it is a breaking ground and marrying something that normally isn't really an area for science to speak on. Science has had no word in morality. It's normally ever been religion or just in the realm of philosophy. So I thought it would be important to really tackle that. Why did you agree to do this project with me here?
Well, it certainly fascinated me that Harris's whole premise, and Harris being one of the more severe non-theists of the Four Horsemen.
Yeah.
While he tries to remove religion from the landscape of morality, I find it fascinating because religion and morality have gone hand in hand for so long. Mm. And his principle is intriguing. And when I read the book, I felt that while his premise was laudable, and certainly justifiable in some of the more extreme examples he gives, he presents his argument as an underhanded pitch to himself, and I feel it's worth taking on and being fairly critical of the easy passes he gave him in his soliloquy here, while still maintaining some of the good points that he's trying to bring out. I think there is a good idea behind it. I think he has played too much to his own bias in creating the argument, and I think it's worth differentiating his bias and his opportunity here.
Interesting. Yeah, and I definitely do want to comment on the easy examples that he draws out, but we'll get into that once we start discussing moral truth here. But before we really get in, I wanted to provide a summary on this book that was given by Paul Chiariello. He is a 2009 Fulbright grantee, and has an MSc in comparative education at the University of Oxford. And his summary, to me, was quite succinct, and I think it hits the nail on the head. So he goes on to say that Harris argues that science is sufficient to answer questions of who we are and what we ought to do. Through systematic observation, he argues we can discover the principles that lead to human well-being. For example, if we observe societies that veil women and commit honor killings, we would see that they produce less well-being for most of their members when compared to alternatives. Now, maybe this particular claim is false, and such societies produce more well-being, but the point Harris seeks to make is that whether it happens to be true or false is something that we can observe. The philosopher only argues that the scientists overstepping the bounds of purely empirical study in making such claims. My response to that particular summary, and to quote Harris from his book, as such, what we ought to do can never be derived from what is. At the same time, we only arrive to what is by oughts. We could never know what is without our ought for respecting evidence. What type of evidence can I provide that would convince you that you should respect evidence? I'd be hard-pressed. Because of this, we must have certain values granted to even conduct science.
Right. And in that, he's bringing a language of Hume.
Yeah.
That he's taking direct
conflict with. His ought, which he does several times, taking conflict with that. So with that summary, and again, with what you've provided, I'd like to get into a few things of what this book is and what it is not, because I think that is definitely important to put forward as we continue the discussion on the system, not confuse many of the assumptions that one could make about the book, which is very easy, I think. So what this book is not, the synod does not suggest that we will hope to resolve every moral controversy through science, but he does believe that we should consider morality as an underdeveloped branch of science. Something else that this book is that science can have a lot to say about human values and principle. It is a challenge to those who believe it is impossible to think about moral truth, that those who believe we cannot converge on the same values for the greater good see that practice as a pipe dream, and that identifying that values are reducible to facts about human and animal well-being. So with all that being said, I think we can really start getting into what moral truth is. And I know, as we've discussed too, there's a lot of language that's used in this book and terms that might have a general meaning, but the way that it's used in this context are important to define. Again, an important lesson that you teach and everyone should follow when engaging conversation is to define your terms and what you mean when you say X. So without further ado, let's get into that. And these are, I think, are the most important terms that we need to remember as we continue this conversation. So one, the moral landscape. The moral landscape itself is a theoretical space whose peaks correspond to the heights of potential well-being and the valleys that represent the deepest possible suffering. Different ways of thinking and behaving, different cultural practices, ethical codes, modes of government, etc., will translate into movements across this landscape and different degrees of human flourishing. Science. What does he mean by science? Beyond just analysis and converting things into quantifiable data, science also entails a desire to understand the world, a respect for evidence, intellectual honesty, curiosity, logical consistency, parsimony, etc. And people must value this to engage in honest conversations regarding science. Belief. Our best efforts to map reality in our thoughts. When we succeed at this, we call it knowledge. It is important to note that when belief actually overlaps reality, it is accidentally true. And he talks about this, if you think about the concept of a broken clock, that a broken clock is correct twice a day, but then it's still failing to function as a clock. And just a quick second, what are your thoughts on that? His definition of belief in that regards, and not to launch the third episode here, but
as a taste of the third episode, yeah, I mean, obviously as a non-theist, he's going to have a problem with belief. Mm-hmm. And he goes into great length at the end of the book as to how he defines belief.
And just to add really quick, I mean, not just being a non-theist, but one who was brought up in a secular household.
He's never been a part of it. It's not surprising that he has a very cynical view of belief. And to think that belief is only right by mere accident, when it actually is. I think it underscores his own disbelief in the religious experience that other people have had. And granted, as a neuroscientist, he is very particular in that way, and that's, as they say, when you're a hammer, everything looks like a nail.
Mm-hmm.
And everything for him typically boils down to its neuroscientific roots. But to throw belief out like that, I think, is throwing the baby out with the bathwater. There is such a complexity of belief within culture, within the personal experience, that I don't think he gets. I think his analogy is a bit hypocritical.
I have to draw attention really quick to the term belief and differentiating that from what he would define as faith and religion.
Right.
I think that you're absolutely right on most of those fronts when speaking about blind faith. I mean, he's definitely repeated several times that if it's right about anything, it's right by accident. And belief is really what bridges that gap between just thoughts that we have, and then reality, and mapping those two over. But let's leave it at that before we start the whole new episode. Going on. when we use the term good, good is what supports well-being. When we use the term bad, bad stands for the worst possible misery for everyone. Evil would be one who would put that, or put all of us in that situation. Well-being should be equal to the concept of physical health, in that it resists precise definition and is yet indispensable. The meaning of both terms remain perpetually open to revision as we make progress in science. In terms of consciousness, this is all we can intelligibly value. So well-being, of course, it's the state that an individual is in, whether he be experiencing happiness or suffering, and that's a pin that you can put in that. But our definition of that is going to change, much like, you know, what do we define as a healthy person? That'll change over time. Right. Who we see as healthy now, living to be 75, 80, 90, you know, 50, 100 years from now, that might be a severe illness. So it changes as we develop senses. Morality. Morality relates to the intentions and behaviors that affect the well-being of conscious creatures. And values. It's the last bit here that I think we need to define. It's a set of attitudes, choices, and behaviors that potentially affect our well-being as well as that of other conscious minds. Any of those terms you think that need any sort of revision or adding on to before we...
I don't think any of those need adding on to, but the one thing that we need to add to the list is his primary objective. Mm-hmm. That if you're looking at morality, a landscape of morality, what is good, what is bad, what is your objective, what is going to be your touchstone, your litmus test, if you will, mm-hmm. that this is a moral truth, this is a moral act. Mm-hmm. And the term, the phrase that he uses time and time again for morality is that you are maximizing the well-being of conscious creatures. Mm-hmm. And as you define well-being, et cetera, we've got that. But that's really what he's trying to push for, is maximizing the well-being of conscious creatures, both individual and collective. Mm-hmm. And that's another issue we're going to have to debate later on, is how well he actually negotiates that fine line. Because he does go into it. Personally, I don't think he defines it well enough when he brings up his straw man arguments, but or his low-hanging fruit, if you will. But throughout the book, that's what we're going to push for. If we define morality according to Harris, then it is maximizing the well-being of conscious creatures. That will be our touchstone. So whatever moral act we're talking about, that needs to be our qualifier.
I'd have to agree. And I think, you know, that summing up our terms, we can go ahead and get into moral truth. You know, just saying this, I think, kind of has a charged meaning. And Harris's position, more than any else, really will see conflict with those like anthropologists, those who think that morality is completely subjective and therefore relative to certain cultures. And actually, I think it might be good to discuss this really quick, because I've been faulted several times in conversation in the past on understanding what relativism is, moral relativism. And it's been my understanding that is a position that basically says that no moral truth can be known, because it's all relevant to a culture, and a culture decides what their morality is. And so in that sense, and then we'll go ahead and get into an example here, if that were the case, then efforts like that Martin Luther King Jr. pursued was wrong. And he couldn't say that it was right, because for the most part, the culture that he was in didn't have any regards for civil rights or the equality of Black Americans. What are your thoughts on that from a relative point of view?
Typically when I hear moral relativism, it's not so much that there can be no moral truth. It's mm-hmm. that there is a moral truth that is dependent on culture. Mm-hmm. Is that one culture cannot look to another culture and tell them what is right or wrong. Dr. King was working within his culture.
Yeah.
And therefore challenging his own culture and its narrative for its moral truth. So there can be a moral truth within that. Now, for one culture then to look to another culture and say what you're doing is wrong, Harris is loath to allow. Mm-hmm. He's adamantly against allowing one culture to be relative to another, and just because a culture is doing it, it somehow makes it sacrosanct and protected. And I get why he's doing that. The problem is, the examples that he keeps bringing up against moral relativism,
mm-hmm.
or cultural relativism, which would be a tenet of anthropological study, is that you allow for the distinction of cultures. The examples he keeps coming up are, as he says himself, low-hanging fruit.
Mm-hmm.
There are clear examples of something that, if you are operating at a stage 5 or 6 level of thinking in Kohlberg's moral thinking, you're starting to quote moral universal rights. And if right to life is one of those, or life, you know, right to protection, regardless of gender, etc., then one culture is going to look to another and go, no, you cannot have female circumcision. No, you cannot kill albinos because they have magical properties
mm-hmm.
for you. And I get that from one culture to another, from a moral standpoint, no, you should be able to stand up and go, no, this is wrong. You cannot do this. From a strictly anthropological study of culture, where you do not want one culture overcoming another culture, or essentially
mm-hmm.
Allowing globalism to wipe out cultures, then there has to be a cultural distinction. But again, Sam Harris is going for those low-hanging fruit. My problem with that is when he throws out relativism entirely, that would open the floodgate to cultural globalism,
mm-hmm.
in which it just becomes one homogenous culture, which is only going to be dictated by the strongest culture that can enforce it. And granted, he's trying to say, if they do that, it should be on scientific means of morality. So whatever they enforce winds up being the best form of morality, which I'm going to debate later, because you can't. Again, he's going for low-hanging fruit. He's going for these extreme measures. I don't think he adequately addresses the everyday aspects of morality.
Sure, and I really want to comment on this here. I think the reason why that he paints these extreme examples is because that if we can agree that this is obviously, and we can say for a fact universally, not a way that we're going to be able to maximize well-being. As a matter of fact, it's the worst possible way to get us in the valley on the moral landscape. And he makes these low-hanging fruit examples solely because it becomes easier to grant a landscape or a spectrum if you see that, you know, this is absolutely like the bad life to live and this is the good life to live. And if you can grant that, then you can admit that there are points of enhancing well-being. And therefore, you can at least talk in a space where the moral landscape is something you can consider as he's putting forward. So I wonder if that's why he doesn't spend much time going into actual examples of reality, because we could debate that all day long. I think for the sake of his argument, he's just trying to find ground where we can at least permit such a theological space to exist.
I think he does it, whether consciously or subconsciously.
Mm-hmm.
Because what he's doing is arguing for a moral act. He's arguing time and time again with the examples he's bringing up that the action is moral or not. And if you do this, it is wrong. If you do this, it is right. The final outcome is the moral qualifier. In doing that, he removes from the table any aspect of moral thought. And this is what Kohlberg studied, this is what Gilligan studied, this is what so much of psychology and moral theorists have wrestled with, is the thought that gets you there. And he very plainly, and he, I mean, his cards are on the table in this, he says, I don't deal with it. This has nothing to do with what I'm trying to do. And in his book, in the first section, he outlines the three projects of morality. And the first one, to be true to him, I'll
show sure,
what
yeah.
he's got. You know, God forbid I'll be off. But he says these are the three projects that we can look at. One, we can explain why people tend to follow certain patterns of thought and behavior, and in the name of, you know, many of them demonstrably silly and harmful, but in the name of morality. Why do they do this? Because it's moral. What is their thinking that leads to this? That's Kohlberg. That's Gilligan. Even Eric Erickson before. You know, all of this goes down to the thinking that goes into it. That's the first project. The second is, we can think more clearly about the nature of moral truth and determine which patterns of thought and behavior we should follow in the name of morality. That's the reflective measure, where we look at what our society is doing, or we as individuals in the society, and whether or not we should do it based on morality.
Mm-hmm.
What does society look like with this moral action? But again, that's what we should do. That's when it becomes the behavior, it becomes the outcome. Three, we can convince people who are committed to silly and harmful patterns, taking out the more ad hominem attacks there,
mm-hmm.
but committed to silly and harmful patterns of thought and behavior in the name of, quote, morality, to break these commitments and to live better lives. So the way it breaks down is that project number one is moral thought. Project number two is more a cultural reflective measure of your moral action. Project three is when you begin to try to enforce that morality or convince others of their immorality
mm-hmm.
so that they follow your morality. And he specifically says that, let's see, their goal, talking about project number one, their goal is to describe and understand how people think and behave in light of morally salient emotions like anger, disgust, empathy, love, guilt, humiliation, etc. This research is fascinating, of course, but is not my focus. And while our common evolutionary origins and resultant psychological similarity to one another suggest that human well-being will admit of general principles that can be scientifically understood, I consider the first project all but irrelevant to projects two and three. So from the get-go, he takes moral thought and throws it out. He's focusing on moral action. The problem is that if you don't understand the action that leads to, or the thought that leads to the action, you're missing the vast majority of the psychology. And my big issue with this is that, as Kohlberg showed, as Gilligan showed, depending on your moral reasoning, you can have high-level thinking and come up with opposite decisions in some of these dilemmas.
Mm-hmm.
And that much of what Kohlberg deals with are dilemmas in which you have an issue and there is no right or wrong answer because both outcomes will have a negative consequence. All the low-hanging fruit that Harris brings up is not a dilemma. They are clearly someone lives or someone dies. Someone is hurt, someone is not.
Mm-hmm.
And it's down to, do you emotionally feel good because your religion says it, or does someone physically get hurt because your religion says it? I don't think he deals in the gray area of dilemma, and I think he purposely avoids it, because at some point, by throwing out project one, moral thought, his whole argument starts to weaken.
Hmm. Do you think it would be useful, especially for the audience, if we went into the specific examples that he drew with those projects on the following page? Thanks.
Yeah.
49.
Yeah, sure.
And all in keeping in mind here that, how can we, when you're done with that, let's try to tie that into his main argument with looking at answers in principle and answers in practice.
Right. So the way he breaks down his three projects by example, he offers, and I quote, "To see the differences between the three projects, it is best to consider three specific examples, rather. We can, for instance, give a plausible evolutionary account of why human societies have tended to treat women as the property of men." That's project one. "It is, however, quite another thing to give a scientific account of whether, why, and to what degree human societies change for the better when they outgrow this tendency." Project two. "It is yet another thing altogether to describe how best to change people's attitudes at this moment in history and to empower women on a global scale." Project three. So we're looking at the rights of women. Whether they are property is defined by society and its moral thinking. Whether a society is better when it no longer treats them that way, or at what point does one society bridge the gap or cross the boundary to enforce the liberty of women onto another society.
So we were going to rope it back into the projects that he gave in, 1, 2, and 3. And clearly, there's value for 1. Should we consider all 3 as we're trying to develop the science of morality?
I think you have to. Mm-hmm. Because we do things because of the way we think about things. Mm-hmm. And some of the reasoning that we use to get to that action, the reasoning is as legitimate as the final outcome. When you hit something that's low-lying, that's low-hanging fruit, like, should women be property? I will still grant, along with Harris, that societies can evolve, that if they can evolve, they can become better. But the practices we have before may not be the best, obviously. Mm-hmm. That as we grow and develop, we find new truths, and we get better at what we do, and do better at what we do, especially with each other. Mm-hmm. Issues with women. By all means, the advances we've made in feminism are tremendous. That women are no longer considered property, they're actually considered human beings, and they're equal, and they have an equal voice, and they should deserve a vote, and that kind of thing.
That's what we're trying to get to.
Yeah, we're trying to get. I know, I went on Facebook just the other day, and there's someone who's arguing against feminism with the most androcentric argument, and they're thinking is what leads them to their moral conclusion that women do not allow, you know, this kind of place or should not. It was around the feminism day, the women's rights, the women's day.
I know you were talking about.
Yeah, because yeah, there's, and someone pointed out, you know, there is a men's day, and that's in November. But it's when, again, it goes to show how terribly androcentric I am, but I can't come up with the term, or the holiday. But, you know, you had the women that were striking to show that you need women in the workforce and therefore they need to be given equal pay and that kind of thing. And this person was just ranting and raving about women needing to do this, how self-centered it was and how it was opposite sexism, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And their moral thinking, you know, from a psychological perspective, I realize it's a defense mechanism to do this. But if you don't understand their moral thinking, then there's no way you can do 2 or 3 in Harris's project.
Well, this is outside of the chapter we're discussing, but that even goes into assuming that there's an author for our actions. And this goes into another piece that he's worked on before, the project of free will and understanding ourselves at the level of the brain. And I think he might be predisposed to argue in this manner as a consequence of his profession, his studies, looking at everything in experience, even who we are, as a cluster of neurons that converge and fire. And scientifically, it's not inaccurate. But that being said, I know we might have to reference this here because I'd like to look at what you just said, that our moral thought is what dictates action as valuable as action is. And I know you've read the book probably as many times as I have now, but you consider the case of our justice system,
right,
and how we determine an action depends on the mental state of an individual. Like if we were to find out that there's a tumor in the prefrontal cortex that completely eliminates empathy and the capacity to make moral judgment in that sense. And he goes through an example. Now, again, this may or may not be low-hanging fruit. I found it to be quite complex to think about that.
Yeah,
someone who doesn't have
a grant you is complex.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One who doesn't have the ability to think of it in such a way, but yet there's still a way to put a spectrum on the actions that he causes the individual that he brings up here. And we should probably go into the examples just so the audience understands what we're talking about here. I can't really quite recall what page that was.
If I remember correctly, in short, you have the example of a Is it a young boy who accidentally comes across a gun?
Yeah, yeah.
And
it's,
kills someone. The second one is someone who has been abused throughout his youth.
Teenager now.
He's a teenager now, been abused throughout his youth, and then decides to kill his parent.
Mm-hmm.
The third one is someone who's led a, you know, a perfectly fine childhood,
mm-hmm.
and then one day randomly kills someone.
For the fun of it.
For the fun of it.
Mm-hmm.
The fourth one, someone who's led a perfectly normal childhood, grows up, decides to randomly kill someone for the fun of it, and you find out in that
right.
individual that they have
correct.
The tumor.
Yes. So those are the four cases. And so based off of the argument or the projects that he's put forth with 1, 2, and 3, can we say that it holds water? Is he right to say that one has nothing to do with it in cases like this? And should we then use that as a universal rule when developing a branch of science on morality in determining what actions or what questions in principle we can answer that will move us up and down this landscape of...
Well, I mean, in that example, there are two sides of the moral issue.
Mm-hmm.
One is killing right. You know, there is a death involved in each and every one of these. And the moral action of that is, no, killing is wrong.
Mm-hmm.
There is no justifiable reason why this person had to die.
Mm-hmm.
The other side of the morality, and that's the one that he's really dealing with, is the justice issue.
Yeah.
Is it retributive or restorative justice that you tackle?
Mm-hmm.
If it's a young boy, obviously they do not have the cognitive development yet to be fully responsible for their actions, so they should not be tried as an adult.
Mm-hmm.
Curious enough, when we live in a state that more and more, especially in the school where I work, as an inner city school, it's becoming more and more of an issue. When we see youth that are tried as adults for adult actions, the outcome is a terrible event. It is morally atrocious. The thinking that led to it, and this isn't even just the moral thinking, this is the cognitive development, this is the biological,
mm-hmm.
neurological development. The child who still has an underdeveloped brain is being tried as one who would have a fully developed brain
mm-hmm.
in their 20s. So the young adult, obviously, or the young child, shouldn't be tried the same as adult because the brain isn't the same. Then you have one who is old enough to know better, but has been morally or has been psychologically scarred their entire, which itself has created a neurological issue and is a neurological problem.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have the third one who just does it for the fun of it. You've got the fourth one who does it for the fun of it, but then you realize there's a tumor, which is creating a neurological issue. And I would even argue that on the third one, where they just do it for fun and there is no tumor, there's clearly a neurological issue going on.
Yeah, and he touches base on the psychopaths
and
that nature.
And I think in this one, when we're looking at the justice system of retributive versus restorative justice, from a moral standpoint, and he points this out, that we stigmatize mental health. Physical health makes absolute sense. If you are diabetic and you have something with sugar, then you need to have insulin in order to maintain yourself. You're just not right. We even have commercials now
mm-hmm.
that say, you're just not right. If you're hungry, here, have a Snickers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you need the chemical balance in order to make you function. And yet when it gets into the neurological, the mental health side, we tend to stigmatize and think, no, it's just your matter of effort. Have you tried being moral today?
Mm-hmm.
Well, obviously you didn't because you killed this person. We don't look at the neurological issues that might have led to this.
Mm-hmm.
Or the societal issues that have led to this and more severe issues.
Roping it back into the projects,
yeah,
I think we can both agree that it certainly is valuable to contemplate your moral actions and how you should conduct yourself in that sense. But I think that then this goes back to, cultures. There are cultures that think that it is perfectly fine
right.
to have blood feuds.
Right.
Granted, they're not the majority of the world, thankfully. But what is it that can just make me say thankfully that it's not? Who are we to determine whether or not blood feuds are good or bad? And that goes into our thinking. So I think does it then falsify all of his work to not consider that step as a project? What are your thoughts on that?
I don't think it falsifies all of his work. I'm not willing to throw the baby out with the proverbial bathwater at this point. My issue with Harris and his project right now is, while it's laudable, I mean, it would be amazing if we could have a moral scale, a moral compass, if you will, that is completely detached from subjectivity. It would be amazing to live in a world where I can cross borders and not be concerned, as one who is a gay man, to be accepted in this society, cross a border, and then worry about getting killed. That would be fantastic. But again, for me, that feels like low-hanging fruit. Of course, from an empathetic point of view, I have to put myself in that other society, which hasn't been challenged with women's rights or LGBT rights. An entire society that hasn't been forced to think and move beyond this because they've accepted it as is. And empathetically, to appreciate that that is where that society is. Do I think it's right? No. But that's also not a moral dilemma. My issue with Harris is that he's not dealing with a gray area of dilemmas. He's not dealing with everyday little pieces of morality. Do I cut this person off? As pedantic as that is, he deals with the big issues. And I think there could be a science of morality that could be used, let's say, for universal rights. But the way he goes about it, I think, is leading to a slippery slope that would allow for globalism, that would allow for cultural homogeny.
I don't think so. I have to disagree there, because I think we still have cultures and yet have a science in understanding what's going to contribute towards human well-being. And I use this example in previous episodes we've had, and he uses this several times too, in considering on how you think about human nutrition. There's no one right food to eat. You know, we're all not going to eat spaghetti every night and become healthy. There needs to be, there's diversity. And you can have diets that are completely absent of good foods that you can have. But not once do I think that he argues that there's going to be one code that we should all follow and a convergence of cultures. But there, at the same time, there isn't an infinite amount of choices that we can make that contribute towards human flourishing. It is finite, and we have to be able to look at those from a factual sense, as facts derived from our values, and say yes or no, is this something we should want? You know, I don't want to keep going back to blood feuds. Let's use several other examples. And a good way to put this, and I thought it was comical, as Harris tends to be from time to time. If you think of two people, let's call them Adam and Eve. There are several things that there are several ways they conduct themselves to happiness or to have a flourishing society of two. Would bashing each other's face in with a large rock be good? No, probably not. So does this get, is it more complex, or is it impossible to think of behaviors like that once we add 6.7 billion people to the mix? It just becomes more difficult. Because cultures are going to exist, and I don't think that's what he's arguing at all. But do you think that in developing a branch of science like this, there would be a convergence of cultures? And again, I'll go back. I don't think so. We obviously have several dietary systems that work, and several people could be healthy in that sense. I wanted to take a few quotes from the book in this passage, just to kind of argue against what we're talking about now. And one of the things that he talks about that will rigging the game of moral truth, that is, that if you take scientific consensus to mean that scientific truths exist and that scientific controversy merely signals that further work remains to be done, but think moral controversy proves there's no such thing as moral truth, while moral consensus shows that only that human beings harbor the same biases, you create a double standard. What are your thoughts on that? And that if science doesn't have a consensus, there's just more work to be done. But the moment that we see that there are some contradictories in human morality, there are biases, and that's it, and no more truth will be done.
My issue with this is that we move from tangible to more intangible areas. If science is concerned about whether or not ether exists, for instance, a time in our history when science believed ether was there and they disagreed, so obviously things need to be further studied to get there. When there is a difference of morality, I would again point towards its moral thinking and its cultural roots. What is the reason for its difference? And if there is a fundamental difference of opinion, and maybe this is finding the distinction between deciding that eating a diet of entirely sugar is bad for you, to your dietary analogy, that eating a diet entirely of donuts is bad for you. Everybody can agree on that, but whether a balanced diet includes quinoa or rice, what kind of grains do you have with your vegetables and that kind of thing, offers a variety that there can be no singular best nutrition.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just so reticent to say that one culture can overcome another in this, because of the dangers of globalism, that if we have a disagreement of morality, depending on the issue, then on that specific issue, there is not going to be a clearly defined term. It will depend on your own bias. It will depend on your own moral thinking. For the big issues, should you kill people? I would say no. But even in that, because I remain and have been moved more towards a side of all life is sacred, and that I recognize the divinity of myself and another, I am left in conflict with those that would see killing as necessary in a matter of defense. If someone is willing to kill you, do you kill them? Do you commit another moral wrong in order to defend what would be a moral wrong? That's the dilemma. Those are the kind of situations that I see as an issue. If you're looking at a blood feud, for instance, a blood feud is awful. A blood feud makes no sense for the well-being of conscious creatures. Do you perpetuate a blood feud? Let's say someone has come and shown up to your door and they're now going to kill you because your dad killed somebody else. Do you defend yourself because you realize the blood feud is wrong? Or, recognizing the cultural context that you're in and the limit of effect you will have on this, do you choose to sacrifice yourself so that the blood feud will finally end and that the rest of your family will not be affected by this? That's the moral dilemma where neither side is going to have a happy ending.
Sure. Yeah, exactly. Which is why it shouldn't be part of culture.
But yeah, exactly. But that's the problem. I mean, if we just reach in and wipe out this, I don't think culture's history. But
yeah.
And that's the thing. I think Harris's issue is that he doesn't deal with the nitty-gritty of everyday life.
Mm-hmm.
That it falls apart when you hit the dilemma.
Well, I wonder if that's where he was trying to go with this book versus trying to just establish a ground for what this would look like as we develop it. At least just getting people to contend that this is something that can exist, just like having good diets, for example. The reason why I find this, I guess we just sum up the moral truth, why I find that this might be something worth investigating or worth considering as a science or developing as a science, is because ultimately, opinions will be constrained by facts of our conscious experiences, our conscious states that we go through, and when we find facts, that is what we can translate into science. What is there to be known about the well-being of an individual, and whether or not we map that through, you know, every instance we run it through fMRI to study it. I don't think that's necessary.
Right.
I think that would be excessive spending and violates parsimony that should be valued in science. But I think we can answer these honestly. And ultimately it goes down to, again, we'll go back to answers in practice and answers in principle. We may never have an answer in practice, but that doesn't mean that an answer in principle doesn't exist. And this is where I think I might be faulted for this by him if this makes it to Sam, but maybe taking out Project One may have been contradictory to how he approaches our opinions or having an answer. And he uses the analogy, in the past 60 seconds, how many people were bitten by mosquitoes?
Right.
You know, as a result, how many will contract malaria? And as a result of that, how many will die? Given the technological challenges, no scientist could give you that answer.
Right.
Worldwide, how many were bitten by mosquitoes? But not being able to answer that, we know still, in principle, it is a numerical answer. That there is a number that exists, but just because we can't answer it doesn't mean that it's there. And so he correlates that to no answers in practice should not be confused with no answers in principle, which could deal with not just thinking, but just the factual state of affairs with morality.
Right. And I may be, perhaps I'm overextending the metaphor, and should Dr. Harris get a hold of this, my apologies for this, and correct me if I'm wrong, which I'm sure you would happily do, with all due respect. But if we can't know how many people are infected with malaria in that 60 seconds, if we can't count the number of stars, if we know for a fact that we can't do it, yet that number does exist,
mm-hmm.
why are we wasting our time trying to approach that number, even conceive of that number, which we can never figure out? I'd rather not figure out how many people died of malaria or have just contracted malaria in 60 seconds. What I prefer to do is recognize that people are being infected by malaria and do what I can in my limited sphere of influence in order to stop that.
Mm-hmm.
If that's what he's trying to say in morality, we can't figure out in practice what the ultimate morality is in principle, then we need to at least try to make some inroads in morality in the limited circles we have, then I'm fine with that.
Mm-hmm.
And that we make inroads in defining morality in the limited circles of influence that we have by scientific means,
yeah.
I will grant that. My problem is when you throw out the thinking that leads to it, rationality, thinking, cognitive development, all of that is still science.
Mm-hmm.
It's psychology.
Sure, yeah. I mean, I find it weird that those projects are, or that he noted that one is irrelevant when a passion to be inquisitive to how the world works is something that is critical to conducting science and is what frees science from just being that machine that observes data and has just an analysis on things that are quantifiable. You have to have that.
Right.
I think that's part of questioning. You know, this particular chapter with moral truth, I think what he's really trying to get at, and I think we might be taking it, or I think that you might be taking it a step further than what he's just trying to argue,
right,
is that if he's going to say that there's moral truth, the opposite of that conversation is that there is no moral truth. And I think what he's trying to say is that it is not the case that there is no moral truth. Because, again, going back to our terms of what morality is, what good and evil is, or good and bad, we'll use those terms probably interchangeably, and how we are positioned on that landscape, there are things that we can point to, a finite number of things, be it then actions or our own principles, that are going to push us towards human flourishing. But why should we concern ourselves with that? I think it's because if we're going to structure a society where we want to continue to live and improve individual and societal health, this is going to play a role in our decisions, especially when we get into population ethics, which is that governs most of the important decisions that we make globally, even. So, but it's a starting framework, and I know that using something as impactful as that could be a strong arm to the argument he's trying to make, but I don't see how it makes it any less relevant. What arguments could you think of, if there are any, that would completely do away with moral truth ever existing? And I guess
an argument that would do away with moral truth ever existing would be the definition of the ultimate good. He offers the argument that it is maximizing the well-being of conscious creatures. I wonder if there is a point at which we realize that one conscious creature, or a specific group of conscious creatures, one species, if you will, of conscious creatures, is a detriment to all other conscious creatures.
Mm-hmm.
And this is certainly taking the lens as a far more macro view. But morality, as is defined, tends to be fairly anthropocentric. It's human-centered, and this is something that Harris even tackles, that morality, is morality necessarily a human-specific study? Can there be morality in other species, or moral acts in other species?
There seems to be, and I'll take a...
And that's, I think that's what we're going to get into when we look at good and evil.
I don't want to blur the two.
But if we start taking a macroscopic view, what is the ultimate good? Maybe it's not even conscious creatures.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it's just existence. What is the plants that aren't necessarily conscious? It's great that they exist. Should all conscious creatures get rid of them? Well, no, because conscious creatures need plants to survive. But what if these conscious creatures are now destroying all the plants?
Yeah.
I mean,
you're getting into some theological space there. I don't want to tread on that. But
in the short answer, no, I can't think of one off the top of my head that would preclude there being no moral truth. I think there can be a degree of moral truth. But my guff remains. That is not so much a moral truth as a moral action, as it were. But what is the moral thought that leads to it? I find the moral thought to be far more complex and far less black and white when we do this. The truth indicates that it's either right or wrong. Moral thought in its complexity shows that there will always remain a gray area.
I wouldn't disagree. And when we have conversations like this, and certainly we're not the only ones who do this, and even discussing making it a science, could that not itself, in the grand scheme of things, here I go speaking theologically, in the grand scheme of things, could that be considered a form of moral thought on behalf of our species towards a moral framework that our thinking in this sense, not that I want to eliminate thinking and just provide answers for people. I think that is equally as damaging. If there's a 726 page book of morality, follow these and you will be well.
Right.
I don't think that is the way to go. And I certainly don't think that is what Sam is putting forward here. But I think what he's saying is if you can stop and think about what will contribute towards an individual's, multiple people's society, what their well-being will look like, that is something that science can help us understand, because it does concern our values. And as I've said before, and as he says several times in this first chapter, that these values can be translated into facts. And I think that is what just piqued his curiosity, because once you understand that, once you can see that values can be translated into facts, then you can make a science out of it.
Right.
And ultimately, maybe it just might be a drive, and I doubt it, because he seems to be more... he seems to have a better drive for it. I don't think he just wants the next Nobel Prize for creating the next best science, although that might be a goal for many scientists anyways. But I feel like he's got a bigger concern with this.
At the end of the day, I'd say Harris's effect, his thesis is laudable. Mm-hmm. I'll grant him that. And that there's a great deal of relevance, and that his premise, when in practice, not principle, but practice,
mm-hmm.
would find tremendous ground in places like the UN. When we look at a Declaration of Human Rights, you know, he gives us grounds to say that is true,
mm-hmm.
and that that is real and possible, that there
yeah.
can be something that is universal in morality. Can we find a universal measure or grounds for every moral action, every moral thought, down to the mundane of every day? I don't think so. I think that will still remain in a degree of complexity and a gray area that can't be defined scientifically.
Yeah.
But to his credit, I think he is giving us a means for the bigger conversations that are far more impactful on global society and global health and security right now.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, we could obviously belabor this to the end of the day.
Yes, no, and I think it's wrapped up pretty much. But again, if we start to see that this conversation is going in circles, we've pretty much covered everything
yeah.
I can about moral truth. And I will recommend it probably 70 times before we're done with this series, that for our audience members, if you haven't read the book, I urge you to at least consider doing that. It's not expensive. It's like $8 on Amazon if you want to get it.
Yeah.
If you've got a Prime account or for Audible, it's on there. You know, you pay your monthly dues, you get a credit, and it's great. At the very least, it's thought provoking and can have an impact on our philosophical thought, as Harris and Dennett have joined in fisticuffs in this realm here. So yeah, so I think that concludes, I would say, succinctly, our thoughts on moral truth and moral science. The next episode, again, we're going to be discussing good and evil, which will be an interesting conversation. As an aside, we originally wanted to do just an episode on good and evil, and I think it's kind of perfect that it folds into this. And you made a note before we hit record here that this conversation itself might go beyond just the book, which
right.
I think is fair. And would probably give credit to the work that not only he has done, but other people as well, in defining what good and evil is. So with that being said, we hope that you enjoyed what we had to discuss today. We hope that you tune in for the next two episodes so that you can understand the full scope of our concerns here and our opinions as well. Again, hope that you pick up the book and read it for yourself so that you can have a sense of context to the stuff that we're discussing. Be sure to like this video if you've liked it. Subscribe to the channel. Visit our Facebook page as well and like it there. We have several updates that come out every other week or so, just to let you know what we're doing. Until next time, thanks for tuning in.
God's peace.